vast opportunity here for people to get better. And the thing about cannabis that's different than those drugs are trying to patch a problem. They're trying to, they're hopefully addressing a symptom that you have, putting some spackle on the wall. Whereas there are many reports in cannabis users, especially when it comes to mental health, that the underlying conditions are alleviated. There's a curative effect. They don't need to stay on these drugs to get long-term benefit. There's a curative effect that goes on with cannabis. I mean, it's not just a covering of symptoms. And that's really fascinating to me and something that is seen throughout herbal medicine. It's not just patching a problem. There's amending that happens. I have a friend who lost his leg while serving in the Army, and they reattached it right at the knee. And, you know, the surgery went okay, but he has been living with severe bone-on-bone pain for the last 20 years. He was in special unit, and he's very adamant about cannabis and drugs. He's not interested in those. He's not going to do those. That's not part of his reality. He might have a beer, that's it. But agonizing bone-on-bone pain for 20 years, when new research came out about the effectiveness of CBD and THC with pain, he got some CBD THC salve, where it's legal in his state, and he started applying it in the spot where the amputation and then the reattachment kind of had happened. And he said within 30 minutes, the bone-on-bone pain that he had experienced his whole life since that accident in the military went away. It didn't just get better. He's like, you don't understand. Like, I've tried to be a good dad and like play with my kids, and I've had to just have this, and it's the most excruciating pain in the world. I've just started figuring out ways of getting used to it, like, you know, trying to use meditation and things like that. Sometimes I take a lot of pills to kind of get it to go away, but nothing ever worked. It's always been there. You know, I can kind of numb it a little bit, but applying a topical CBD THC salve to that spot locally, just right there, within 30 minutes, it penetrated deep enough to get rid of the pain. And the cool thing is, it worked that fast in the first application, but now he doesn't even really have to use it much anymore, because he believes, and this is a guy, again, he's like special forces. This guy's not some dude who's hanging out, like, you know, ripping bong hits, you know. He believes that there's a curative thing going on. He's like, I used to have to apply it every day, which was great. I'm totally fine with that. I only have to apply it once every couple weeks now, you know, and it's starting to taper off. So he's like, I believe that there's something happening in there. That there's something, whether or not bone's repairing itself, or whether or not maybe my nerve endings are starting to understand, hey, stop sending pain signals. Something's happening. So there's a curative effect going on, and you'll see a lot of reports of that with cannabis.
If someone has really severe MS, for example, they are losing their mobility. They might even lose their ability to drive. They may then lose their ability to work. Chronic pain can keep people from their activities of daily living, from going to that birthday party with their grandchildren and really getting down on the floor and having fun with their kids. There's lots of ways in which you just aren't the same person you were before an event happened. And for every person, that's different. You know, I read like a crazy person. So if I had to be stuck in a chair reading for days, I might find that a relief. Somebody else who's really a mountain climber might find that debilitating. So again, what you lose is, it depends on how important it is to you. And the point of using this medicine or any other medicine is give you back as much function as possible, but even more so give you back some control over what happens to you.
So every time we get an injury, stub your toe, cut your finger, something like that, there's a pain signal, right? That's a good thing. We want the acute pain signal, but we don't want that pain signal to continue for hours or days or weeks, then it would become chronic pain and that could be a problem. How do we stop that acute pain signal when it's time to stop it? It's a cannabinoid mechanism in the body. So the cannabinoid receptors at the terminal of that pain signaling nerve, it's called a C-fiber nociceptor. When those receptors are stimulated, it shuts down the pain signaling, decreases all the sensitizers and activators to that nerve, and it quiets down over time. So that's a homeostatic kind of first line of defense against chronic pain that we're all using all throughout our lives.
So there are several different ways that our endocannabinoid system is affecting the way that we perceive pain and the way that our body responds to it. The CB1 receptor, that's cannabinoid receptor 1, is found throughout our central nervous system and is integrally involved in how we perceive pain. We also have CB2 receptors, cannabinoid receptor 2, CB2. Those are found largely on our immune cells and immune tissues, which are directly involved with inflammation and therefore pain. So when we think about the ECS, now we have those two receptors that are involved in pain perception and also pain and inflammation. And we know that when our body like gets a noxious stimuli, like something that will hurt us, we start to see endocannabinoid activity ramp up. So we have this noxious stimuli. All of a sudden, we see anandamide and 2-AG binding at CB1, which helps to turn down that perception of pain, and also binding at CB2, which helps to reduce inflammation and thereby reduce pain. We also know that anandamide works on this other receptor called TRPV1. TRPV1 is another receptor that's really important in pain perception and inflammation. Anandamide binds directly to TRPV1 to also turn down those signals.
Pain system is a huge, I mean, we all think of pain as this horrible, to be avoided at all costs kind of thing, but pain is actually a very important part of our body, at least on the acute level. Stick your hand in the fire, you damn well better need to get it back out, right? And that's how you know. The problem is we can have derangements of that system that lead then to inappropriate sensations of pain that persist. And that's what we need to be able to address in healthcare. And as one can imagine, then the endocannabinoid system is deeply involved in both the signaling of pain and the perception of pain. And those things, interestingly enough, are different. And I think that's one of the areas that we don't have quite enough attention being paid yet. You know, we can talk about pain as starting sort of at a point of origin, like I stick a scissors into my hand by accident, and so my hand is now going to have damage that causes release of chemicals as well as neurologic impulses that then eventually tell me that I should take the scissors out of my hand. These pathways travel through my arm and up through my spinal column into my brain, etc. And actually, interestingly enough, then there are systems in the brain that fire back down to the hand to say, okay, look, calm down. I understand that you're in pain. We've removed the scissors. You can chill out now. The endocannabinoid system is actually involved in multiple places through that chain of events. So we've got some involvement right here at the local area where I put the scissors. And then we've got involvement in the spinal column where the cannabinoid receptor is complexed with the opioid receptor, and that's really important when we're talking about how we can use cannabis in conjunction with opioids. And then there are a number of centers sort of in the higher levels of our brain where those endocannabinoids come into play as well. And that's where we get into a little bit of that split between the perception of pain, the perception of the signal of pain, and the perception of the feelings of pain. What I often talk about is sort of like there's this, objective isn't the right word because it's subjective, but it is sort of a concrete, is there pain, isn't there pain kind of thing. But then there's this other component, which is our emotional reaction to that pain, the suffering, right? One of the things that cannabis does particularly well is it detaches or eliminates that suffering. So if you have, say, knee pain or back pain or something, and you take cannabis and you think, does my knee still hurt? The answer is, yeah, my knee still hurts. So you can think about it and pull it and say, is the pain still there? And the answer is yes. But the next question is it bothering me? And the answer is no. And that is where cannabis lives and works best. The area of regarding opioids is that we can use opioids to diminish those signals as they come up the spinal column. And because the opioid receptor is connected to the cannabis receptor, we can get a similar stimulation through the phytocannabinoids, the cannabis-based cannabinoids, which means that we don't have to use an opioid to get that benefit. Or if sometimes because the pain is severe enough, we do need the opioids, we just need a whole lot less. And the less opioid we use, the safer people are. So the combination of cannabis with opioids is really an amazingly wonderful cocktail if we need opioids at all.